Thank you. This event is put on every year, or has been since 2011, by the Valdosta Lowndes Chamber of Commerce and the two Rotary Clubs here in Valdosta. We are excited, as you've heard, to have the Board of Realtors and the Home Builders join us for this event. And we want to thank them for being a part of it. We also want to thank today several groups who have helped make this event possible, our Chamber VIP sponsors. And I'd like to ask them to stand when I call their name, if you would, after we get through, give them a round of applause. The Coastal Plain Area EOA, the Coleman Tyler Law Firm, the Home Builders Association of South Georgia, the Lowndes County Commissioners, Renaissance Bank, and the South Georgia Military Affairs Committee. Could you all stand if you're here, and let's give you a round of applause. Without their good hard-earned money, this event would not be possible. I also want to give a quick special recognition to the lady that works at the Chamber, Patty Martin. You probably bought your tickets from Patty, and she has done an excellent event selling this event. We have around 280 folks here. So if you'll give Patty a hand, we really appreciate it. We changed the format for this event a couple years ago, and it's worked out well because, you know, these folks like to talk, so we like to rein them in a little bit here and there. But we asked them to come up, and we've got some specific questions for them. And I want to say before we begin, you know, we're lucky in this area. This is said a lot of these events you'll go to, but we're lucky, one, to know all these people personally, call them friends, and be able to call them at any time. And there are people you can approach and talk to at any time, I'm sure you all know. And the second thing is they all stick together for us in Atlanta. And that's very important as the landscape of Georgia changes from metro to rural and the divide that's there. We need every bit of unity we can get in Atlanta for the issues that come before our area of the state. So I want to thank them for doing that every year and acting in that fashion. And I guess we'll start off, and I've got to get my glasses on so I can see what I'm going to start with. Let's start off with Senator Black. LSU, you know, in the last few weeks, we've heard a lot, specifically from the governor the last couple weeks, about the pending water legislation between Georgia and Florida. And I wonder if you might just comment on how that may affect, or any legislation coming out of that will affect, our agribusiness community in South Georgia.
Well, it certainly has the potential to have an enormous impact on the Southwest Georgia. I don't think there's any scientific reason whatsoever at the time. Those of us in the Swan River Basin, any of the problems is not just over here. But still, Southwest Georgia is very vulnerable depending on what comes out of this court decision. And got sure plenty of lawyers here, other people served in the court process knows it. They'll tell what a jury will come back with, and they'll tell what a judicial panel will come back with. So I think one thing that my personal judgment is when this thing is all over and done with, it's going to give the impetus to see us go ahead and develop some reservoirs up in North Georgia to provide the land with the water that they're going to need. The challenge has always been to get past the people that object to any kind of a dam or any kind of a reservoir, and they've gone to court and blocked a lot of our efforts to go ahead and get it done. But I think that when this is over done with, you'll see something like that. The folks that's over south, West Georgia, there's no telling what the court might order to deal with this. Once they make the ruling, then we have to deal with it.
Jason, since you have the microphone, I'll go to you next. Our former Senator Tim Gold has been on the statewide committee dealing with the rural charitable hospital tax credit. And I know you've been involved in that. Could you kind of talk about that a little bit and where it's going? What do you see happening with it?
Yeah, you're talking about that. We passed that piece of legislation during this past session this year. And the idea came from a metro legislator up in Forsyth, Jeff Duncan, which was kind of out of the blue, but he said he was sitting in a meeting at his church one day, I think, and he's just hitting me. It's like, we're trying to figure out what to do with rural hospitals and rural health accessibility, in particular the funding issues that they all face. And we've had five of them to shut down now. The closest one to us would be over in Charlton County, which Ellis and John know more about that because they've represented that area. But yeah, it can happen. We've got rural hospitals all around us that are struggling. And we've got, you know, South Georgia Medical Center here that either owns or manages now Nashville, Lakeland, and had worked with Homerville for a long time. So it hits home. But Jeff's idea was to take kind of like what was being done with the private school, the Gold Scholarship Program, which was a tax credit program where people can, you know, in lieu of the credit, then they can designate where they want the money to go. So it's kind of like you're steering the money and having some control over where it's going. With healthcare, you know, there's so many strings attached with a lot of the money that comes down, either from Atlanta or Washington or wherever. So that was the other reason. You can designate this money, this investment, and get. So the way it worked, I think when we passed it out of the House, I was the second signer and worked on it through the rural caucus. And we passed it, we had it set to you get an 80% credit on your investment up to the limit. And it started out, I think, at 100 million. And it got over to the Senate, and they messed it up a little bit, but as they're good at doing. But anyway, I think they changed it to 70% credit and dropped it down to 50 million of total credits during the year, and we put a cap at 4 million per rural hospital. And we didn't monkey around with the definitions of rural hospitals. We kept that was an existing definition, you know, dealing with population and critical access and all those different factors that were already existing. But anyway, I think it's about 34, maybe 35 hospitals that qualify for the funding. Cap at 4 million per hospital up to the total cap of 50. That number will go to 60 in year two, 70 in year three, and then it'll sunset. And then we'll go back and look at it and see if it did what we wanted it to do, if it worked. My fear is if we don't get the word out about this, then you might not even be able to raise the money anyway, and that would be a total failure. But the goal is to have an avenue to try to steer some money to rural hospitals that are struggling without all the strings attached coming down from DCH, where they can spend the money as they see fit, as they know. So it's like anything else. I think any decisions made on the local level are going to be more efficient, smarter. They know where their needs are more than somebody sitting in a cubicle somewhere knows. But that's the whole purpose behind it. I called, they called me and said, who would be a good person for our area to really go out and try to help, you know, do some, get the word out, maybe go visit some industries and so forth. And I said, well, Tim Golden doesn't have anything to do anymore, so call him. But anyway, I knew Tim would be gracious enough to lend his time to that. And I think you're starting to see some information coming out there. So if anybody's got any information, this will start rolling out next year for next year's tax year. So it's a heck of a bang for your buck. As an individual, I think you can put $2,500 or $5,000 if you file jointly, but for a corporation, it's a percentage of your total state tax liability that you can get the credit. And so it's a 70%. And so there's a pretty good bit of money that can be raised there. And if you want just an idea of a good local hospital to designate that to, I would highly recommend SGMC Lanier. But anyway, it's a good program. I think it's a good kind of public-private partnership avenue, and I hope it's going to work well. So please, so think
you,
about it.
You didn't have to put everything in blind trust like Trump.
Hey, that hospital's owned by the South Georgia, by the Lowndes Hospital Authority, so it'll help all this whole region when you help that hospital.
Thanks for that. Amy, you want to comment?
Yeah, I just wanted to note that you may not know this, but we have a caucus called the Rural Caucus. And any member who's a member of the Rural Society of House of Representatives, is it joint too, Senate? Yes, joint Senate and House. But Jason is the chairman of this committee, and that is monumental for us because we meet every single week and we talk about rural issues. We meet for lunch, have a speaker come during the session, and talk about the things that we need to be hearing about our area. But it's the second largest caucus in the General Assembly, second only to the majority caucus. So we have a great following behind our leader here, Jason Shaw.
I know how to get people there. I always have good food. Andrew, go ahead.
Let me add this to what Gretchen just said, and make a little different thoughts on it. The maximum that can be contributed to a couple thousand jointly is $5,000. But most middle class folks are gonna have a state tax liability of $5,000. You turn around and make that contribution to the hospital, you get a 75% tax credit, which is $3,500 you're gonna be getting back. Then you turn around and file the federal tax return, it's a deduction, and if you're in the 30% tax bracket, you get your other $1,500 back. So if you got $5,000, do you send it to the state or you send it to one of these little hospitals? It's your choice.
Good information. Amy, let me ask you, you're our education expert, and that's what you do in your regular job. You know, we've seen the failed opportunity school district legislation and a lot of initiatives out of the governor's reform commission. What do you see coming down the pipeline in education in 2017? And before you start, I want to let everybody know, in the last couple of weeks, Amy, tremendous appointment, has been appointed as one of the members on the committee on assignments in the House, and I'll let her explain what that is and how that may affect our area, too.
Okay. And I'll start with that since you said it last. So the Committee on Assignments is a committee that is put together by the Speaker of the House to help him to lay out all the committees, each of the members, and assign those committees to the members, to find the best fit for each one of the members. The Speaker is not required to do this. It's really that's his job to do that. But he decided he wanted to lean on some of the folks who he trusts most to help him do that. So he has a few people who are by title on that committee with him, but he picks about a handful of people who he thinks would be a good representation and good folks to help him in that process. So this is actually my third term that I'm doing this. He asked me to do it back this 4 years ago now, and then 2 years ago, this is my third time doing it. So at the beginning of January, we met a few days ago in Athens, and we'll meet again in the beginning of January and start laying out all the committees and the appointments that he's going to assign. So it's pretty good for our community, especially because I get a say in trying to help our members get what they need. And we're very diverse in our backgrounds, so it benefits all of us because we can serve on a variety of committees. We serve on a few together, but very few. We try to spread out a little more so we can know everything that's going on, or at least as much as we can throughout the General Assembly. So that was a big honor. Moving on to education, there are some things that are cooking, if you will, with the governors. The OSD did fail, and I personally, as an educator, felt like I teach in a school system where none of our schools have failed for three consecutive years. There are none in my district of three counties that have failed for three or more years, but I personally felt for those citizens who live in a community with schools that have failed for three or more consecutive years, those citizens deserve a right to vote on that legislation, on that amendment. And so I certainly supported allowing our people to vote on that. It did fail, but there are still failing schools that need to be addressed. And so there's some legislation in the works. We have a member from North Georgia who's highly involved in it. He's working with the speaker and other areas of the state to try to find the best approach. He gave us a little bit of information when we were in Athens this past week, but we don't have all the details yet, but that will probably roll out very soon. So listen out for that. I had a really great appointment this past, during the summer and fall. And I'll preface it with saying, 2 years ago, the governor appointed an education reform commission. And he got people from a variety of different areas to look at education and to try to figure out, give him and us some good recommendations for improving education in the state. So they came out with numbers of recommendations. I think it was somewhere around 44 of them. And so he decided this year, instead of going ahead and starting to push them, to let the teachers get involved. And as a classroom teacher still, he decided that he wanted to name me the chairman. I had 90 teachers from across the state of Georgia on my commission. There were 30 from high school, 30 from middle, 30 from elementary, all different areas. We had special education, CTAE, fine arts, all the academics, and we had a great, out of 90 teachers, you can find a good assortment of them throughout the state. And they all came from, 30 came from South and Central Georgia, 30 from Metro, and 30 from the North region. So it really worked out well to have a wonderful group of teachers to do this. Now let me tell you this, there are two things of great concern to me. One is that approximately 44% of all teachers who start teaching in a classroom leave the profession within 5 years. And the second thing is this, our University System of Georgia numbers show that about 16% less students are going into those colleges of education than in the past. So, and we've always lost them. I mean, I'm not saying that 44% is any much higher today than it was 3 years ago, but we have to address that. So our committee got together, the commission, and we came up with a variety of different recommendations for the governor. One is strategic compensation. I just read that a teacher, a classroom teacher, starts out making about 17% less than similar professions, similar qualifications, people in other professions. So that's something that we definitely need to look at. Teacher induction programs, that's to address the turnover rate. If we could get more mentorships, teachers mentoring other new teachers, some kind of additional support for those teachers when they walk into that classroom. I'm telling you, I went through Valdosta State University, and I got my degree, and I walked into the classroom the first time. Nothing prepares you for your first day and your first year of teaching. So we're looking at more induction programs in a stronger way. Consistency with the curriculum and the different programs. They say we change it way too often, I agree. We need to stick with some of the legislation that we pass and not try to change it all the time. And lastly, that I'll just mention, is a media campaign. And that addresses that whole 16% that I mentioned earlier. We need to do a real strong campaign to try to encourage folks to go into the profession. We need to clean up some things, but teachers are not really encouraging students to go into it, unfortunately. Teachers at my level, the classroom teachers. And so that's something that I'm actually going to be the star and the very first one that will roll out in early January. The GPB is coming to Lowndes High School next week to video me in my full-time job. So, thank you.
All right. John, I'm going to turn to you. You served over the last several months on the Military Affairs Senate Committee. As you know, this community does everything it can to support one of its biggest economic engines in the Air Force Base. And we as a chamber do with our South Georgia Military Affairs Committee. Tell us about that committee's work, what we may see come out of it, and if specifically, if you know of any efforts on the statewide level to coordinate support for military bases in Georgia.
Good question. Thank you, Brad. First, I'd like to thank our host. The meal's wonderful. It's great we get to do this to help inform the public, get the good information out there instead of the bad information that a lot of time gets out there. It's great to be among friends. Great to see Emmett Nolan with Buddy Carter's office here, as well as Jody Reed, our senator from Johnny Isaacs. Thank y'all. Brad, Georgia has 9 military bases in the state, starting with Moody Air Force Base here locally. We got Robbins, the Warner Robbins, Marine Logistics Base in Albany, Benning over in Columbus, Stewart over in Hinesville, Hunter Army Air Base in Savannah, the Naval Base, Submarine Base down in St. Mary's, Fort Gordon up in Augusta, and Dobbins up in Marietta. So we've got 9 military installations. We have the fifth largest military presence of any upstate in the nation, except for California, Texas, North Carolina, and Virginia. That's the only 4 that have more than we do. Florida's right behind us at number 6. The military employs 150,000 military personnel in the state, as well as 178,000 civilian jobs or off-base jobs. this equates to over a $20 billion impact on our state's economy, which is huge. We also have 750,000 veterans that call Georgia home. That's huge to the state. Locally, Moody contributes to about $500 million to our local economy. They've got about 5,000 military and about 5,000 off-base jobs. They have a huge footprint, just like you just alluded to. It's huge for our local economy. Our committee, we were charged with going around the state talking with military, civic, community leaders to try to come up with the best things the state can do to help defend and strengthen our military base. An overwhelming recommendation that just about everywhere we went was a concern, education. That's the top concern. While we're doing great here locally, Amy alluded to that our schools here, none of them are on a failing list. They're doing good at, you know, Lowndes, Valdosta, surrounding counties. Georgia as a state ranks 35th in the nation for K-12 education. That's a huge issue. One thing they're doing in Albany, they have an intergovernmental agreement between Lee, Daugherty, and Worth counties where any dependent of a military person can choose where they want to go to school. That's huge, and I think we'll see some recommendations coming forth to encourage that all across the state. Then, like Amy said, we've got some stuff coming from our Education Reform Committee coming out, and hopefully that can get our number from 35. We need to be top 10. We need to move the needle on that. The other thing, an issue that come up is encroachment and infrastructure issues. One of the recommendations that's been made is developing an economic development grant that they can use to help those infrastructure and problems around the military base. One state creates what they call a brag zone around the military base. And what they do, they go in the state, then in agreement with the landowner for not developing that property, they will either offset or help pay for the property taxes on that piece of property. That's another thing being looked at. Licenses for our military families, this is huge. These families that transfer, a military family will move about six times during their military career. So, you know, they move, you know, the military person, he goes right to work. But that, you know, the spouse that comes in, if they are professional, if their license will not transfer, it takes them 6 months to get that license. That's a huge problem. We've got to come up with a reciprocal agreement when we get these licenses. When they get here, they need to have the license handed to them, all right, let's go to work. That's a huge problem. Broadband is another huge problem, just about every base we talk to, high-speed internet access. We had Larry Hansen come up and testify for our committee when we was at Warner Robins about the economic impact of Moody for this area, but also the problems where we could help. And one of the issues that's just huge here is the internet access outside the gate. At Moody, these families that live around the gate, a lot of them don't have internet access. It's being compared to the electrification of rural Georgia back in the 30s. It's that important. It's not a luxury, it's a necessity nowadays. And as a result of Larry testifying for our committee, Representative Roger Dickey happened to be there because he's from the Warren Robins area. He was not on our committee, but he is on a rural broadband study committee. And he invited Larry to come testify to their committee as well. So I haven't seen their final report, what it's going to look like for us. Incentives, tax breaks, public-private partnerships, what the recommendations that have come out of that committee, but it's a huge issue, and we're definitely looking at it. We're going to push that forward. One of the major factors that a committee looks at when they're looking at doing a BRAC, realignment closure committee, is the military value of that base. They don't look a whole lot at economic value to it, but they look at the military value. That's the main thing to look at. That includes military readiness, the mission that they have, the ability to accept future missions. But another issue they look at is the quality of life for their military warfighters as well as their families. And I think that's where our state and our local governments can help have the biggest impact. We want to make life as worry-free as possible outside that gate for these military families where they don't have to worry about it when they're off halfway across the world. They realize their family's safe and worry-free. You know, we can't take anything for granted. We can't take Moody or any of our bases for granted. In 2005, the last round of BRAC, we lost four military bases here in Georgia. with all support. That's almost a third of the bases that we had in 2005. So that's why it's important that we be proactive. If you wind up on that list, it's too late to go to work. You've got to start, you know, 3 or 4 years ahead of time. If you wind up on that list, there's an 85% chance that your base will be realigned or closed. So we've got to be proactive as a state, as a community, as our leaders in Washington. We need to keep pushing them to help us all they can. And our speaker told us last week, as a state, he'd be proactive. He made this committee a permanent working committee where we can continue to work on these problems, keep pushing them forward, make sure we don't drop the ball. So we've got somebody pushing issues forward all the time. So he's done that. So I think that's a great step forward right there. In closing, I think we would it's our defense of our nation should not be budget driven. I don't know how it ever got to that point, but I don't think it should be. And then I'd just say thank you to all our military personnel that they're serving our veterans.
John, following along the lines of the comments you made about being proactive, do you think there will be anything specific coming out of that committee to coordinate the efforts in our state to actually support that? For example, in South Georgia Military Affairs Committee in city and county, we all work together all the time to make duty brat-proof to the best of our ability. We heard a couple years ago on our trip to Washington from the Association of Defense Communities that most of the states besides Georgia that have military activity have a coordinated statewide effort, but Georgia does not. Is that going to be something that happens this year?
That is definitely something being looked at. I think we make this a permanent working committee. We can continue to push that forward as we talk about maybe making that a permanent under the Department of Economic Development, a permanent committee or part of economic development. That's probably where it should be. So I think we definitely hopefully see that coming in the future.
Okay. Next, you brought up an issue I hadn't thought about, but it's getting some significant play in the media, especially around Atlanta, and that is a renewed effort. It didn't pass a year or two ago, but coming up again on a gaming casino type issue, and how that might affect us. I think the talk is there might be four to six around the state licenses. What's your take on that, Dexter?
For one, everybody wait, because I know if you eat. So everybody just sit up a little bit, because I know it's kicking in. But thank you for this opportunity to be here today. But when you're looking at the gaming in Georgia, you know, because a lot of people come into Georgia, they want a lot more entertainment, and they're comparing us to other places that have the gaming, horse race, casinos, things like that. So what the state that I have involved, and a lot of people that are in the General Assembly, we're looking at how the income can really help in our education area. And a lot of you know that our whole things like that are based on merit and, you know, our university systems. But we need to look at also a needs base. So I think that it would get more of my support and a lot of my colleagues on the Democratic side of things, that if we can look at it, let some of the money go for the needs-based people that really could use the help a lot, but also tied to merit, but more so, you know, needs-based, because a lot of people need a lot of money. I know most of you guys know education is not free. And right now we see the tuitions are going up at our universities, and we're trying to work on that at the same time. But I think if we're going to have the game come into Georgia, we got to make sure it really benefits our Georgians, and more so educational hope too, or something like that.
Okay. Thank you, Dexter. While you have the microphone, are there any specific legislative agenda items you're going to bring forward in this session?
Well, one thing I would like to bring up, and because of my history, 25 years in the healthcare industry, healthcare is always a big issue. There are a lot of people here that have high premiums. There are a lot of high medical costs. And what I'm looking at is, you know, Medicaid expansion was one of the big things that we were talking about, but with the new administration, there's going to be a lot of changes. But the uninsured in the state of Georgia, that's the real big issue. And no matter what happens, whether they're talking about the Obamacare being scrapped, which it has good points and it has bad points. But before we come up with a replacement or the president administration come up with a new plan, I know there are things that they may cut out that are bad, but they're going to look at the good portions of it. We've heard through the news that's what could happen. But in the meantime, it's going to take a while for any kind of thing to happen as far as changing it, because you have so many people that are using the Obamacare system, and January 31st, you're gonna have people still enrolling up until that point. So even if there's a change, it could be a year, 2 years, but you still have a problem with over 500,000 people in Georgia that are eligible for Medicaid that's gonna still be without insurance. And you know who pays for that? The ones that have insurance and the taxpayers. When we have almost 12 to 13 hospitals looking at closure in their eyes, we gotta do something. I'm happy that we have the, you know, credits you can get for putting money in, and you know, that's a good thing. But that's not gonna be enough how rapid the costs are going in the state of Georgia. Another thing we gotta look at is when people do go to the hospital, to the ER, that don't have physicians, the hospitals will suffer because their indigent funds are going up higher, and we're still paying for that. So we got to do everything we can, and we have problems with our standing Medicaid. So like Jason and I were talking, if we're going to expand something, let's work on making it a little bit better before we can expand it. Okay? And if we do expand Medicaid, we need to work on the reimbursement for the people that will accept it. Because we have a lot of providers that say, I don't want to take Medicaid because I'm not making enough money. I'm losing money. And so we have to listen to that and do what we can to work with everybody. But I'm looking forward to what the president and what he's going to do with health care. A lot of things I heard about letting the insurances be a little bit more competitive. I'm for whatever's going to work. It doesn't matter to me who the president is, long as they do their best job to try to take care of the people. Because if you don't have a healthy community, you really don't have a community. Thank you.
Thank you. And you got a microphone. Let me ask you, and I'll ask Ellis this as well. There's a couple of issues that we as a chamber advocate for every year. So I ask specifically, and also generally, specifically the Invest Georgia program that we've been trying to get funded for several years, and the sales tax holiday, which are on the front borders, and Tim Golden started several years ago. I'd like you to speak to the, you know, what you think may happen with both of those, but also generally anything from an appropriation standpoint. I know you're a subcommittee chair, so anything you see. Ellis, I asked you sort of the same question, which you can see.
We actually heard from the governor yesterday at lunch up in Athens, and he gave us a good overview of where we are. We know that in 2017, the fiscal year, which started July 1 of this year, 2016, that our state budget was set at $23.7 billion. And revenue is up. It's up as of year to date from fiscal year 2017, it's up 4.8%. So that's good news. It's up 4.8% since last year's numbers. So we're doing better this year. I wanted to just mention that this is a huge and monumental announcement to make, but let me explain. The reserve fund, which is what we dip into when needed, a rainy day fund, as you've probably heard it referenced also. When I came into office in 2007, 10 years ago, it was $1.6 billion. And I can't remember how many days that would run the state government, but we're supposed to have it within a certain amount of time, a month or so, or something like that. But anyway, in 2011, when Nathan Deal took office, it was down to $116 million, which would have run state government for 2 days. $116 million. So he made the decision, a goal, to reach $2 billion by the time he left office, which will be in two more years. Yesterday, he announced that we're at $2.05 billion in our reserve fund. So we are thrilled to be making some money and hopefully have some opportunity to invest in some of these things that we find to be extremely necessary for our state, but we've not had the luxury of having the money to spend on that.
Ellis, you want to comment on
that? I reckon maybe just to better accentuate those figures, with the amount of money we had, when the economy turned bad, there wasn't enough there to keep us from having to do austerity cuts in education. See, our budget just dropped down to the point. we were just making cuts, it was just past cutting out the band, we was cutting down to the meat and bone. Budget is always a challenge, because there's always more wants and needs than there is money that's available to do something. And I forecast that the biggest challenge we're going to have is addressing a backlog of pressure on our state employees, and the fact that most have not seen a wage increase in 8 years. And we've got certain of areas that it is atrocious, and that we're losing people that we have invested in training, because other states and other areas are paying so much better. The governor's already announced that he's going to propose a 20% pay raise for public safety employees, which includes troopers and DVI, these folks. And I found out that we got state troopers that we have invested tons of money in training, and they've come out making just a little over $40,000. And we were losing a bunch of those folks who were going to Texas and starting out at $60,000 a year. And an example that sort of, I think, maybe hits better about here in South Georgia, a major challenge for us is to our forest department's got to fight fires and try to protect our forest land. It takes people that's got CDLs to drive these trucks on these little tractors that fight forest fires with. We ain't paid enough money to get out here and be competitive in the market with someone with CDL, so we've actually hired some people, put them on the payroll, and having them get the CDL. And then as soon as they get the CDL, loggers have been coming along and offering sometimes twice as much as what we're paying. And folks, that's not the way to do this. And so we're going to be faced with the challenge, not just only making that budget balance to include the governor's proposal to address these public safety people, but we got a lot of other areas of state employees that need to be addressed. And when you start talking about pay raises across the board, you're talking about serious money.
About law enforcement, the governor announced back in September that it's his initiative, and we'll have decided we're going to support it, that we would do pretty much across the board 20% pay raises for law enforcement. Not until he mentioned it yesterday did I understand that our Georgia State Patrol ranked 50th out of 50 states for pay until this pay raise will put them at 24th. That's a big deal. Anyway.
Jason, we're getting closer to time, but we'll finish up with you. You're chairman of the Industry and Labor Committee, and I know on the federal level we looked at getting rid of the overtime regulations, which was going to be a big burden. What about on the state level? Anything coming out of your committee to affect our everyday business life?
Well, we've, and that was good news about that court case the other day, and I know the feds have appealed it, so we'll see what happens there, but we were already looking at ways to somehow respond to that and using any kind of, as far as seeing what we could do on the state level, because that would be devastating, not just to the private sector, but that would also be a huge loss for the state government and local and just across the board. But and our committee this year, you know, we'll always have some bills filed dealing with the minimum wage bills and things like that. But not too much. I've got some meetings up there next week with some of the legal community, so we'll see if y'all have worked out any battles, and then we'll deal with that.
We always have something for you. Well, I want to thank each of you for being here. Thanks for what you do for our communities. We really appreciate it. A funny story, I was sitting at the red light at Ashley in Northside the other day, and I looked over to my left, and about this much of John is visible from a hole on the new on the new red light project. So I know they work for a living, and I know it's a big sacrifice to take off for 3 or 4 months and be in Atlanta. So we really appreciate what you do. And with that, we'll bring Molly Deese up to make some final remarks. Thank you.